If your document looks like this, can you automate a TOC that looks like this? Yes, and I'll show you how, coming up. Hi, I'm Deborah Saavedra with LegalOfficeGuru.com, your resource for using Microsoft Office in a legal practice environment. And I recently got a question from a reader about a document she was working on that she really needed an automated table of contents for. She writes, I work in both the real estate and transaction areas of law and use table of contents rather frequently and consider myself fairly advanced in using styles. I still have one issue that I have not been able to figure out. Would you please give me your professional opinion on whether or not the TOC can look like the snippet below, and if so, how to accomplish it? She sent me a couple of visual snippets to show me what her document looked like, which I've mocked up here. If you know anything about generating an automatically updating table of contents in Word, though, you immediately see a couple of possible barriers to using styles to populate that table of contents. The article number and the remainder of the heading, the first level heading, is separated by a soft paragraph break in the text, but needs to be separated by a tab in the TOC. The number in the second level heading is bold in the text, but needs to be not bold in the TOC. Other formatting inconsistencies, such as use of all caps and small caps, don't necessarily preclude using styles to populate the table, but the other two inconsistencies I just mentioned already mandate that we use TC fields rather than styles to create our table of contents. TC fields, aka table entry fields for table of contents, are the legacy way of marking text to include in a table of contents left over from pre-ribbon versions of Word. While using styles to populate a table of contents is the preferred method, TC fields offer some advantages. One, you can customize the content of the TOC entry. In other words, it doesn't have to match exactly with the text of the document itself. Two, you can also customize at which level your TOC entry will appear, regardless of how it appears in the hierarchy of the document. And three, you can include TOC entries that aren't based on headings. Granted, TC fields are a little harder to set up, but in situations like this where there are inconsistencies between the way the entries appear in the document versus the way they appear in the table of contents itself, these fields give you some needed flexibility. To build this table of contents to Carol's specifications, I'm going to 1. Mark the first and second level entries with TC fields. 2. Deal with the content inconsistencies between the headings in the document and the TOC entries. And 3. Revise the styles for the TOC entries to include bold facing, all caps, or small caps as appropriate. Before getting started, I need to turn on Word's Show Hide feature so I can see the non-printing characters, which will also include the TC fields. To do that, click the button that looks like a paragraph character on the Home tab. Microsoft really prefers you build your TOC with styles. They prefer it so much that they've literally hidden the command for marking a TOC entry. It's not available on the ribbon, and unless you already know the shortcut key Alt-Shift-O, that's holding down the Alt and Shift keys simultaneously and pressing the letter O, you wouldn't have a clue how to insert a TC field. If the shortcut key works for you, great. However, I prefer to see this command on the ribbon so I don't have to remember it. To put that command on your References tab, right-click anywhere in the gray area of the tab and choose Customize Ribbon. That will bring you into the Options dialog box. First, I'm going to add my new command group to my References tab to hold this command and call it TOC. I click New Group. Once I have References selected, which it is by default the way I came in here, and then click Rename to rename it. Now I have to find the Mark Entry command to put into that command group. Since I know what this command is called, I can either choose All Commands or Commands Not in Ribbon, and then scroll down the alphabetical list to find it. Once I've found it, I can choose my new command group, then choose Mark Entry, and click Add to add it to that new command group. Once I've done that, I can click OK to finish, and I'll see Mark Entry TOC on my References tab. To mark a TOC entry, simply select it with your mouse or keyboard, and either use the shortcut key Alt-Shift-O or the Mark Entry command you've just added to your ribbon. That will bring up a Mark Table of Contents Entry dialog box. In this example, you'll notice immediately it really only picked up the word article and the number after it. That's because there's a paragraph break, in this case a soft paragraph break, inserted with Shift-Enter. Here's the first of our manual adjustments, typing in the remainder of the heading into the entry field. And now here's the second manual adjustment we need to make. The TOC will need a tab character between the article number and the text of the heading. I can't insert that within the Mark Table of Contents Entry dialog box, but I can insert it within the resulting TC field. To do that, though, I need to finish marking this entry. I'm going to leave the table identifier as C, and because this entry will be the first level of the TOC, I'll leave the level at 1. Then I'll click Mark to finish, and then Close. Once I've done that, Word will insert a TC field after the text I've selected. The TC field is made up of three parts: the text of the entry, as it will appear in the TOC, within the quotes after TC, the table identifier after the backslash F, and the level after the backslash L. At this point, I can manually type a tab character after the article number so it is included in the TC entry once I insert the table of contents. Now, because these two words are so close together relative to the tab entry, you're not going to be able to see that, but I'm going to mark one more and just show you how this ends up looking. I'll mark another level 1 entry. Mark entry. And then when I insert the tab, you'll see it there. Now let's see how our table of contents looks with just these first level entries. On the far left-hand side of the References tab, I'll click Table of Contents, Custom Table of Contents. That takes me into the Table of Contents dialog box. First, I need to decide whether the entries in the Table of Contents should be hyperlinked. The advantage is that it makes navigating within the document easier, both while you're editing, you can control-click to jump directly to the reference text, and potentially once you've converted your document to a PDF. The disadvantage, however, is that if you have any reason to convert your table to text for more editing, only necessary if you find that the table contents feature doesn't allow you to meet a certain requirement, the converted text will also have hyperlinks, which can be a bit difficult to remove. The choice to uncheck the box is yours. Within the table contents dialog box, click Options to open the Table of Contents Options dialog box. These steps are critical to getting this particular type of table of contents right. Because Microsoft prefers you use styles to build your table, that's what's selected by default here. Uncheck both that box and the Outline Levels box, since heading styles are usually also linked to outline levels. Then check the Table Entry Fields box, then click OK to go back to the Table of Contents dialog box, where you can click OK again to finish inserting the table of contents. Immediately, I see one discrepancy between my table and Carol's. Her level entries are all in caps in bold. I could simply select the entire table and make that change to the formatting to all caps in bold just manually, but that would be counterproductive because those changes would be undone every time I refresh the table of contents. Instead, I'm going to modify the style that controls the formatting of the Level 1 TOC entries. To find out what style that is, I'll use Shift F1 to bring up the Reveal Formatting pane. And when I click my cursor inside any of those entries, I see this. The paragraph style entry tells me exactly what I need to know. These entries are controlled by the TOC1 style. So I click on paragraph style, and that hyperlink takes me directly to the style dialog box. Now, in some cases, more than one style is applied to a particular piece of text, and Word does its best to guess which one you want to modify. In this case, it went automatically to hyperlink. That's not the one we want to modify. Instead, I'll scroll down to TOC1 and choose that one, then click Modify. That takes me to the Modify Style dialog box. I can do some formatting changes like boldfacing within this dialog box, but to choose all caps, I need to click Format, Font, to go to the Font dialog box. Once I've chosen bold and all caps, I can click OK to make those font changes, click OK again, and then click Apply to change the TOC1 style. Now my table of contents first level entries are all in caps and boldfaced. Now we can start marking the second level entries. The process starts the same way. Select the text with your mouse or keyboard, then use either Alt-Shift-O or the Mark Entry command you've added to your References tab of the ribbon. The tab character that will need to appear in the eventual TOC entry is already embedded into the text of the document, so there's no need to compensate for that with these second level entries. These will be level 2 entries, so I'll choose that level within the level field and click Mark. By the way, you can mark multiple entries in the document while Mark Table of a Contents Entry dialog box is visible. Just scroll through your document, select the text for your next entry, then when you click back into the dialog box, the newly selected text is in the entry field. Check your table identifier and level, click Mark, then move on to your next entry. Click Close when you're finished. Once I've marked all of my second level entries, I can go back to my table of contents and refresh it to add them. To do that, I can either click inside the table and press F9, or I can right-click anywhere within the TOC and choose Update Field. Either way, Word will ask me if I want to just update the page numbers or the entire table. Because I've added new entries, I want to update the entire table. Once it's updated, I need to compare it to the result Carol wanted. I see two discrepancies. One, Carol wanted the headings to appear in small caps. These appear in mixed case. This is something I'll need to fix in the TOC2 style. Two, Carol wanted the entire heading to appear in regular text rather than having boldface numbers. This is something I'll need to fix within the TC fields themselves. Let's fix the second problem first. Within each of the TC fields, I'll need to remove the bold formatting from each of the entries' numbers. To do that, I'll select the numbers within each TC field and use either Ctrl-B to toggle off the bold facing or use the bold command button on the Home tab. Once I refresh the TOC, the numbers are no longer bold, but they're still bold in the body of the document. To force the second level TOC headings to be in small caps, I modify the TOC2 style using the same process I used for the TOC1 style. namely going to the Modify Style dialog box via the Reveal formatting pane. So I will find the TOC2 style, click Modify, Format, Font, Small Caps, OK, OK, Apply. And once I've done that and my table of contents is refreshed, everything looks as Carol envisioned it. Before you refresh your table of contents one final time, be sure to turn off Show Hide by going to the Home tab and clicking on that Paragraph button to toggle that off. Otherwise, your pagination might be thrown off by the TC fields. I told you earlier that Styles is really the preferred way of building a table of contents, but that the TC fields method also works and gives you some flexibility with formatting and content. But now you've seen that flexibility can introduce some real complexity into setting up the table of contents. So that begs the question, is it worth it? Your preferences are your preferences, and you're absolutely entitled to them. But the more inconsistencies you insist on between your document's formatting or content and your table of contents, the more manual labor it takes to meet your requirements, and the less automatable everything becomes. So you have to ask yourself, how much value are your exacting requirements really adding to the document? Be honest. Those are questions only you can answer. And as I said, you're entitled to your preferences. What you're not entitled to, however, is any insistence that Word automate your every formatting whim. Word's pretty flexible, but it's not a mind reader. I know that's uncomfortable for some folks to hear, but it's reality. If you'd like a copy of the sample document I've just demonstrated, head on over to my blog at the link in the description and scroll down to the bottom of the post, or click the link in the upper right-hand corner of this screen. This has been Deborah Saavedra with Legal Office Guru. Thanks for watching.